Here goes Davis.
Oh, my gosh.
Davis is going to run it all the way
here
back.
Here comes pressure. Bortles sees it coming. Looking for Wharton in the end zone. Wharton behind the defense. Oh!
Are you kidding?
Talent, and we had an auction, so I was over there emceeing that. So there were all kinds of activities going on in Manhattan yesterday, but the best one this weekend, right now, the kickoff of the spring football game.
We are set to go. Ian Patterson out of Rockbridge in Columbia, Missouri will kick it off, and with the win, this one will be fielded at the 4-yard line near side and taken to the 15, to the 20, to the 25, to the 26-yard line by newcomer Andre Davis. He is taken down by linebacker Shermichael Moore on the play. So our first look at Andre Davis, a junior college wide receiver from Baltimore by way of Santa Rosa Community College. And one thing we know about him, Stan Weber, he can really run.
Yeah, speed is one of the main things that he can give the Kansas State Wildcats today, starting with the backup white team.
Well, here we go. The number twos with the white club here today, starting from our left to our right from the 26, from the near right hash mark. And there's the snap to the quarterback. This is Jesse Ertz, hands the ball off right side. Jarvis Leverett with the play out to the 32-yard line for five. And free safety for the number one defense, the purple defense, Dante Barnett with the tackle.
That's a pretty impressive way to start for this offense, going against the first-string defense to run the ball 6 yards.
Dante Barnett, of course, closed the season so strong last year. Over his final four games, had 32 tackles, 3 interceptions, including one in the bowl victory against the Michigan Wolverines. Two receivers wide to the left, wing to the right. Here's a handoff on a stretch play to the right side, and not much this time. A yard to the 33 before Morgan Burns makes the stop on the ball carrier. Again, that is Jarvis Leverett. Jarvis is, as we talked about in the pregame show, a redshirt sophomore out of Katy, Texas, played at Cypress Lake High School. A year ago, of course, didn't play, redshirted in 2012, but very, very talented guy, 5'11", 203-pounder.
And that time he had to meet a cornerback up at the line of scrimmage as Morgan Burns, the new starting cornerback on the left side, was there to make the tackle.
Third down, 3 to go from the 33-yard line for the white team. There's the snap to Jesse Ertz, throws far side. Ball is caught for a first down by Stephen West out at the 38-yard line, just inside the numbers. Over on the far side, Randall Evans and Nate Jackson collaborating on the stop for the Purple Club. Just underway in the ball game with no score, 13:34 to go in the opening period, and a pretty good start for the white squad. Let's go down to Matt.
Yeah, Wyatt, Matt Seiwert, the Conway Springs product, has already come in. I don't know if you guys noticed it up top, but Travis Britt's got dinged up on that opening kick and has been limping around quite a bit, so they've brought him out. And again, Seiwert in the contest for K-State.
All right, we'll keep an eye on that. There's the snap to Ertz. He throws to the near side. That's Cody Cook with the catch. But Randall Evans drives him into the turf back at the 34 for a loss of 4 on the play. If you're familiar with the name Cody Cook, you probably are a pretty good K-State football fan, knowing that he was a quarterback a year ago. He's a wide receiver now. Stan, he's a very good athlete. He punted at Hutchinson Community College at one point. He knew about everything.
Yeah, out of Lewisburg. He's a pretty big receiver and learning how to play that position after playing quarterback for the Wildcats last year.
Second down and 14 from the 34 for the white squad with no score as we approach 12 and a half minutes to go in the first, and Jesse Ertz will be pulled down by Ryan Mueller, or at least stopped. No tackles of the quarterbacks in the spring game. So basically, if you touch him, he is ruled down, and the sack back at the 29-yard line will make it third down and 19. Jesse Ertz is an interesting young guy. The fact that he's got good size, 6'4", right at 200 pounds. You look at some of his numbers, Stan Weber, as a high schooler, staggering in the state of Iowa. Good-looking young player.
Yeah, and getting some good experience here today.
Third and 19 from the 29-yard line. Ball between the hash marks in the center of the field. Ertz back to throw on a three-step drop. Now he's going to run the football. He'll take it to the 35, and just shy of the 35-yard line, and a couple of tacklers. Jonathan Truman was there, and Will Davis playing the middle linebacker position, and the Wildcat coaches, and in particular Mike Cox, excited about him. So fourth down for the white squad. And Mitch Lockbiller is going to come in to punt, and back deep is Curry Sexton at the 30.
Sacks equal punts, and it does on this possession, as the biggest play was Ryan Mueller on that second down sack.
There's a good snap. Here's the kick by Mitch, and this one is a low kick, which is a good strategy And this is fielded on a hop by Curry Sexton, and he takes a knee at the 32-yard line. So the Purple will take over there, first and 10, with 11:19 to go in the opening period. Hey, homeowners, no matter if your home project is big or small, don't make a judgment call. Always call 811 two full working days before you dig. Also, a quick hello to KVSV-FM in Beloit, 105.5 FM, carrying our spring broadcast today. Wildcats in the Purple and White spring scrimmage. There's the snap. Jake Waters back to throw on first down for the number one offense, and he winds up and throws it deep, and it's off the hands of the receiver at the 27-yard line. And that's former Manhattan High product Deontay Burton. Coverage on the play by Cree Moore, a young man from Oklahoma, who the Wildcat defensive coaches are excited about. That was an awfully good throw by Jake Waters with the wind, and Burton almost caught that just off his fingertips.
Yeah, good throw by Jake, judging how strong the wind is behind him. He's thrown this ball here a lot. Starting on the offensive line, Drew Little, who's a backup center, starts at right guard, and Matt Kleinsorge is the right tackle.
Here's Jones, right side. Nice crease here, and he'll take it close to the first down near the 41-yard line. A gain of about 8 on the play before he's pulled down by Donnie Starks. Donnie, of course, a cornerback for the Wildcats, number 2 white club here today defensively. Well, our first look at Charles Jones. We mentioned in pregame he's so excited about an opportunity to get on the field today in this spring scrimmage, and a nice gain there. It's 3rd and 2 from the 41. There's the snap to Waters, throws far side, catch is made, and Deontay Burton stretching for a first down. He's got it at the 46. Cree Moore is the tackler. And so Deontay Burton, who played in 9 games without a catch a year ago, gets a first down for the Purple squad in a nothing-nothing game, 10:35 to go in the first.
It's nice to see him get that first catch because, like you said, the post pattern wasn't an easy ball to catch, but he had it hit his hand. You want him to gain his confidence, and that time he got a catch and got a first down conversion.
Burton goes wide right. Curry Sexton and Kyle Klein to the near side left, and Waters to throw. A little bit of pressure out of the pocket to the left with a flag down, and he is touched and down at the 41-yard line by Tanner Wood, who we mentioned in pregame, a young man who redshirted a year
holding
ago.
Offense, number 55, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Number 55 is one of the Wildcats' best offensive linemen. That's Cody Whitehair trying to protect his quarterback there. And maybe a little bit of a grab on Tanner Wood.
Think about his career, Wyatt. He's started for 2 seasons, done an amazing job. 3 of those starts at right tackle, and then a bunch of them at left guard. Now he is starting at left tackle for the Wildcats.
Very, very fine athlete. First down and 20 after the penalty from the 35, and a swing pass left side to Jones, and he sidesteps a man at the 35, takes it to the 40, to the 42-yard line for 7. Tanner Wood in on the stop, and Weston Hebert was also there, the youngster from Gossel, Kansas. Downstairs to Matt.
Well, I want to mention a couple of guys, and Deontay Burton's name obviously has come up, guys. He brings a little size. He's put on a good 15 to 20 pounds now at 205. He's a guy that can go get some passes, maybe that a couple other wide receivers can't. Athleticism, and also on the defensive line, Will Geary, the former Topeka High football standout and wrestler. He's a guy that's been causing problems for offensive linemen during the spring.
Throw to the far outside, and up the ladder to get it is Curry Sexton, and he's bumped out of bounds far short of the first down. Couple of tacklers there, Donnie Starks and Cree Moore. That pass high, and again Curry goes up to get it, but it's going to be 3rd down and 11 as he goes out of bounds far side at the 44-yard line. No score, 9 minutes to go in the opening quarter in the spring game, the Purple and the White.
Good job by both those backup cornerbacks getting up there and making a quick tackle at the line of scrimmage.
We await the snap, and there it is to Waters. Pardon me, Jake back to throw, now being pressured out of the pocket. Starts to run, and now to the sideline, he'll just throw this one away. Pretty good play there by Jake. He's been around long enough now, knows to get rid of it, and he was forced out by Cree Moore. We mentioned just a moment ago that Cree is a guy that these coaches really believe has a chance to be quite good. Broken Arrow, Oklahoma product. Very smart young guy, wants to be a mechanical engineer. A red shirt from a year ago, good-looking corner. Cree wears number 23. Well, the Purple will punt here, their first punt of the day. Nick Walsh is in the game, and he'll punt it with that breeze and a spiraling kick, and a fair catch is called for and taken at the 7-yard line into the arms of Judah Jones. Another Wildcat who redshirted last year.
Well, we haven't talked about special teams very much, and this is a real question mark. How about the kicking from the punter? Is it Nick Walsh, a redshirt freshman? He came last year in the spring. He was here for the spring game. Mm-hmm. And then as a walk-on, redshirted last year, he is getting the first shot with the purple, and Mitch Lochbieler is the other punter who punted for the white. And those two guys are in a heck of a battle to see who is going to end up being the K-State punter to start the year.
Redshirt sophomore Joe Huebner now in at quarterback. He's from Cheney High School in Cheney, Kansas. Gets the snap, gets that ball right in his hands and fires near side. Andre Davis thrown to the turf immediately by Morgan Burns. The catch at the 18-yard line, so a gain of 6 on the play on the throw by Joe Huebner.
The thing I like about Huebner is the velocity he has on his passes. He's very comfortable now being in the offense. And he's played very well. Even though he is probably the third-string quarterback for K-State, he's looked better than that.
Nice job there. We approach the 8-minute mark of the opening period. No score. The white with the football for a second time. Here's a handoff, and this is Jarvis Leverett starting right. Back to the middle he goes. A couple of yards to the 20 and into the hands of big Valentino Coleman, who makes the stop for the Wildcats. He played in 10 games a year ago. He's from the College of San Mateo and really kind of takes over for Shaquille Reed and has done a nice job this spring.
He really has. It's the one position where you're going to have a new starter on the front wall with Reed gone, and so far it's Coleman who's stepped up the most in spring.
Judah Jones goes wide to the far side left. Here to the near side, it will be Andre Davis. Here's the turn and the give, and this is Jarvis Leverett straight ahead, and he takes a couple of purple shirts with him all the way to the 25-yard line for 5 and a first down. Sure, Mike UL Moore made the stop, but Mike would be the first to tell you he didn't have a real great angle on that play and got dragged a couple of yards for a first down. First down at the 25 and a half.
A good hole opening on the right side, and you're right, when he got there to make contact, he was on the side of the running back Leverett. There's no chance he could stop his momentum and keep him from getting a first down.
Huebner barks out the signals, gets the snap, now dances to his left, throws back into the middle and off the hands of Jarvis Leverett. Will Davis, middle linebacker, among others, there in coverage for the number one defense. That's the purple squad. As we go under 7 minutes to go, no score in the opening quarter. Warm, windy day here in the Little Apple as we close out another spring season and look forward to next fall. The Wildcats will open on August 30th against Stephen F. Austin. An early Big 12 trip to Ames, Iowa before Auburn, who played in the national title game last year, comes to the Little Apple. We'll talk about that schedule a little bit later on. John Curry scheduled to join us in the third quarter, and here's a throw into the left flat, incomplete, intended for Cody Small, a tight end, covered by Will Davis. And Cody is another newcomer to this football team. He is a young guy who's a redshirt freshman from Cypress, Texas. And when you hear Bill Snyder talk about him, you know he likes his strength and his size. He's got a chance.
He hasn't used up any eligibility yet either. That's what's amazing. He's been here as a 2012 gray shirt and then last year redshirting.
Third down and 10. Huebner is going to run the football to the 30 and short of the first down at the 34-yard line. Jonathan Truman is the guy that made the stop. The white needed 10. They got 9, and it will be fourth down. And we'll see Mitch Lochbieler come in to punt and Curry Sexton back deep for the purple squad. No score, 6.5 minutes and counting. Time remaining in the first period. From Bill Snyder Family Stadium, Coach Snyder down there in a suit and tie. Looks a little odd, though, with that boot on his left foot. He had surgery this spring. Here's the kick and into the wind. That thing is just a dying duck, and it's fielded at the 40-yard line by Curry Sexton with a timeout. 6:09 to go in the first and no score. This is the K-State Sports Network from Learfield Sports. The ball game here this afternoon.
Yeah, a Hall of Famer when you think about college football, and then a very good pro as well. He was so solid, and he really exemplified everything a Bill Snyder football team is about. Just quietly dominated and then just got better and better and better. Didn't care about what people said about him and just didn't make mistakes. Not only did he make great plays, he didn't make any mistakes. And what a linebacker he was. Dominant, fast, and very smart.
Wildcat weekends are made better when booking with the new Bluemont Hotel, located next to K-State in Aggieville. This boutique-style hotel offers a chic design, suite-style rooms, and distinctive event space. Book today at BluemontHotel.com. Running play here for Charles Jones to the outside, and he's pushed out of bounds by Donnie Starks at the 46-yard line. So four on that play for running back Charles Jones. He is a redshirt sophomore from Mandeville, Louisiana. Three-year high school starter, rushed for 1,700-plus yards and 22 touchdowns as a high school senior, getting his first real opportunity here, wearing purple here today in the spring game. Second down and six after a gain of four for Jones. Here's another handoff to Charles from Waters, and he will take it close to the first down and appears to have it. Nose of that football just over the midfield stripe. Linebacker DeCorey Johnson is the tackler for the White Squad. And DeCorey is another young guy who the Wildcats hope to keep healthy this year. He came in from community college ranks a year ago, and Stan got banged up. And really, I don't think we ever really saw the real DeCorey Johnson, did we?
No, but he has the potential to get on the field, Wyatt, and make some plays. Remember, his brother is Quincy Morgan, who had a coming out party in the spring game back when he was a junior college transfer for K-State.
First down and 10, play fake here. Waters wants to throw, being pressured, rolls the pocket to the right, fires wide of the intended target, incomplete over on the far sideline. That one for Kyle Klein. Quarterback pressure coming from Leighton Dowling, the senior defensive end from Dodge City. Good effort there by Leighton.
So far, the theme of the first quarter would have to be the defense. Very strong so far. The backups have not allowed the first-string offense to move up and down the field at all. And then, obviously, going into the wind, it's been a struggle for the first-string, for the second-string offense to go against the first-string defense.
There's the snap. Jake Waters hands it off for fakes to Jones and now runs to the left and got the corner, and he's pushed out of bounds inside the 45 at the 43-yard line, a gain of seven. Sean Newland from the secondary, young guy who played at Phillipsburg High School, pushes him out of bounds. This is another guy that the Wildcats believe will be a really fine player at some point. Some have compared him even to a guy by the name of Ty Zimmerman. That's pretty good company, wouldn't you say?
Yeah, it's very good company. I think Sean Newland has a real chance to develop, but a lot to ask of him right now as a redshirt freshman. He is the backup currently to Dylan Schellenberg.
Third down and three, 43-yard line. Waters for the Purples, throws far side. Deontay Burton the catch, and he's got a first down, and then push back. They'll give him forward progress to the 38-yard line. Weston Hebert, who has been such a fine special teams player for the Wildcats over the last couple of seasons, makes that tackle from the secondary. A former high school linebacker and an All-Stater makes the play. No score, 4:35 to go in the first quarter from Bill Snyder Family Stadium. Sexton Burton and Daniel Sams now come wide to the left for Jake Waters and crew. The Purple with the football in the white territory. And this is a stretch play to the right side to Jones, and he is upended after a gain to the 34, a gain of four by Weston Hebert. Stan, your thoughts so far on both Charles Jones and for that matter, Jarvis Leverett so far. What do you think?
Well, they both are doing okay. You need to get into a rhythm before you really see what these guys can have. After you get pounded on a little bit, you see what kind of moves they make. It's been solid, not spectacular yet to start the game.
Hope you're enjoying the game today on the K-State Sports Network and or K-State HD TV, if that is your mode of choice. Here's Jake Waters to throw, and down the middle he goes. Has his man, but it's off the hands of Curry Sexton right at the goal line and incomplete. And Curry not happy with himself. That's pretty obvious from the body language. He had a chance for a touchdown there and just couldn't pull it in. Coverage provided by Sean Newland. I think you'd certainly have to say pretty darn good throw by Jake Waters there.
A great throw. It was a play that took a while to develop from in the slot running down the hash mark. Curry Sexton stopped about 15 yards down and then took back off, got behind a safety, Sean Newland, and the ball was delivered to him perfectly at the goal line, but unusual, he drops the football.
Wide receiver right, twins to the left, Waters to throw on third and six from the white 34. Out route here and short of the first down, and a sliding catch at the 29-yard line by Zach Trujillo, pulled down by Donnie Starks. Good to see Zach make that play, really kind of almost with his back to this quarterback. Nice catch, though, and is shy of the first down by about a yard.
It's fourth and a little over 1 yard. They're not thinking about a field goal. Even with the wind behind their back, they're staying out there with the offense, going for fourth down.
Trujillo, tight right. Curry Sexton, wide right. Wide receiver to the left side is Deontay Burton. Gronkowski in the game for the first time, and they block for Charles Jones, and it looks like he has enough for the first down near the 28 into the arms of Trent Tanking. He goes. Tanking is a young Wildcat linebacker from Holton, Kansas, and a good one, good size, good tough player. And he pulled down the running back, but not before a first down for the Purple. We're at the three-minute mark of the first period. The Purple and the White in a scoreless battle to this point. Maybe a little bit of a surprise to some. But I think, you know, Bill Snyder said something, Stan, pretty interesting at his media gathering on Tuesday, and that is that the defense has been a little bit more consistent than the offense through the entirety of the spring so far. I think we're seeing that here today, too. Back to throw is Jake. Waters to throw. Far side and overshoots Deontay Burton, covered by Cree Moore. Just outside the numbers at the 5-yard line, just shy of the sideline. And so now a second down coming up. Here's Matt on the sideline.
Hey, Wyatt and Stan, from a couple plays ago on the drop by Curry Sexton, Danzel McDaniel got hooked up with a wide receiver. And it was interesting to hear Tom Hayes, the defensive coordinator, say, hey, you got to get off of that. You can't let him tie up. And I'll tell you what, guys, K-State's had some smallish corners. McDaniel is not small, 6'1", 205, and he is chiseled, good-looking player.
Yeah, I think he's going to do just fine. He's still learning. Coach Snyder says he's still kind of buried at times, trying to learn everything. And here's one into the middle for the tight end, Zach Trujillo. He's got a first down all the way to the 14-yard line, a gain of 14 on the play. Sean Newland and Donnie Starks in on the stop for the White. First down for the Purple, and our first real scoring threat of the afternoon comes late here in the first quarter with 2:25 to go.
Zach Trujillo had only 5 receptions last year and 7 for his career, but I think he'll be a bigger factor catching the football that time, getting himself wide open over the middle between the linebackers, and is able to get a first down inside the 15-yard line.
14-yard line near left hash. First down for Jake Waters and company. There's the snap to Jake. Hands it off to Gronkowski. To the 10, to the 5, to the goal line. Wildcat touchdown for the Purple and Glenn Gronkowski. He's in there from 14 yards away. And the Purple scoring first. It is 6-0.
We spoke about running backs, but a guy who's going to carry the football as well as the fullback this year, Glenn Gronkowski. Only one attempt last year. He was a big play player, catching the football, not running it. But this year I think you're going to see his running abilities. He takes it in up the middle for a 14-yard touchdown to put the Purple on the board.
Outstanding run there. We'll see about the point after coming from Jack Cantelli into his second year as the Wildcat place kicker. This one is a low-line driver, but it is up and good. And the Purple leads in the ball game 7-0. With 2:03 to go in the first quarter. Scoring drive, 12 plays covering 60 yards, and it takes 4 minutes and 6 seconds. So Cantelli with the PAT, 7-0 in favor of the Purple. And the Cats scoring in the Case IH red zone. Productivity counts in the red zone. Learn more at caseih.com/be ready. See Straub International with 7 locations. Visit straubint.com. Garrett Bowl is happy with me that I got that in there. How about that? Good to see you, old Garrett. How are you, G? Everything's good?
2-0 runner than a lot of people know.
Good kick here, and that is over the head of Andre Davis and out of bounds. Off the toe of Ian Patterson. So the White will have it after the touchback with 2:03 to go in the first, trailing 7-0.
Jesse Ertz will get back in as the quarterback. They're switching, it looks like, every other series between Ertz and then Joe Huebner.
Niver, Hayes, Bergstrom, Ash, and Ajani Brazier up front in that offensive line for the White squad. Cody Small, the tight end, is on the left, and Jesse Ertz, as Stan mentioned, back in the game. Gets the snap, hands the ball off. This is Jarvis Leverett. Nice stutter step move here to the 31-yard line for a gain of 6. Couple of tacklers, Dylan Schellenberg and linebacker Jonathan Truman there for the Wildcats. Truman has played in 39 games, started 13 times a year ago, and had 89 tackles. That was second on the club a year ago for K-State in an 8-5 season. Second down and 4. Jesse Ertz in the gun. Reed Bergstrom to snap it to him. A 4-man front for the Purple defense. Ertz hands the ball off, and this is Judah Jones with a carry. Thought we might get a chance to see him run the ball a little bit today. He'll take it to the 33 for a couple. 2 more tacklers, Randall Evans and Dante Barnett, for the number one defense. That's the purple defense right now. A minute 10 to go in the first quarter. And the purple leading 7-0 on the 14-yard run by Glenn Gronkowski.
Bill Snyder always looking around to see what combinations work best. We heard talk about it on the offensive line. You remember Jordy Nelson switching over from defense to offense. Well, here's an example where you have a guy in Judah Jones as a wide receiver, but he's getting some work at running back.
There's the snap and the give, and a nice run here. First down all the way to the 40-yard line. Jesse Ertz handing the ball off that time. And a real big hole right up the middle. Shermichael Moore on the stop of running back Jarvis Leverett.
Well, you mentioned a guy, Reed Bergstrom, who played at Butler County Junior College, walked on to Kansas State, was a tackle, but has started to learn the center position. He was right in the middle of the offensive line that opened up a hole against the first-string defense on third down. And Wyatt, we were talking about the running backs. I'll say on his two runs on this possession so far, we've seen a difference in Jarvis Leverett. Two very good runs.
So far, the total yards, not all that much separation between the purple and the white. And Ertz throws to the far side. That ball caught near the 45 to the 47-yard line by Steven West. And Nate Jackson, a corner, immediately makes the stop. So pretty nice throw and catch there. Jesse Ertz throwing it. A gain on the play of 7. It's second down and 3 from the 47 near midfield.
Ertz has thrown the ball pretty well. We've talked about the arm strength.
The end of the first quarter.
That's the end of one with the purple leading 7-0. Second quarter next after a timeout. This is the K-State Sports Network from Learfield Sports. Welcome back to our coverage of the Wildcats. One quarter in the book, the purple leading the white. Our score is 7-0. Our thanks to KQAM in Wichita, 1480 AM, for being part of our network broadcast today. Saw our network affiliate Representative Daniel Brower in town yesterday. Great to see her. And we've got 14 affiliates carrying the spring game here today. We appreciate each and every one of them. 7-0 purple after one. Purple with 81 yards in total offense, 45 of that rushing. And the white with 52 yards. And here's Jesse Ertz running past midfield and is touched after a first down at the 47-yard line by Dante Barnett. Lone score of the first quarter, Glenn Gronkowski's 14-yard run, capping a 12-play, 60-yard drive. Donnie Starks had 5 tackles for the white squad in that first period, leading the purple squad defensively, Cree Moore, Jonathan Truman, each with 3 stops. First and 10 for the white squad. Jesse Ertz out of this great state of Iowa with a high snap, looks left, throws that way, has Cody Small, 44, to the 40, to the 38-yard line right at the hash mark. He'll pick up about 8 on the play. Dylan Schellenberg and Jonathan Truman, the tacklers for the purple.
Backup offense, the white team, gaining a little momentum here. Why?
Yes,
you see some
are.
Excitement. You know, you see some guys like give you a fist. Even though they're not in the play, they may be on the other side of the field. They're really happy when a guy makes a first down. They know how hard it is to go against the first-string defense. And you mentioned how at the end of spring, the defense really picked up the pace, and they were playing better than the offense.
Here's the turn and the give. This is Jarvis Leverett right side, and close to that first down, appears to have it near the 36-yard line. Randall Evans, among others, leading the charge there defensively for the Purples, who have a 7-0 lead in the game. We're starting to see a few more receivers. We mentioned Andre Davis. We saw Stanton Weber in there, Steven West in there that time for the white squad.
And they get another first down. Now they're at the 36-yard line going in.
I'm sure those out there listening and or watching saying, give us an update on how Daniel Sams is doing at wide receiver. We'll do that here in just a moment. First and 10 from the 36 for the white squad, down 7-0. As we go under 13 and a half minutes to go here in the first half. Good snap to Ertz, and now they stop play, and looks like a delay of game coming.
Offense, 5-yard penalty, first down.
And a real learning chance right there for Jesse Ertz. You got some momentum, you're first and 10, you got the wind at your back, you cross midfield, and you lose 5 yards. Now, it's hard enough to get to 10 yards against the first string defense, and now you got an extra 15 just because you as a quarterback didn't get the snap done quick enough.
See what happens here on first and 15 from the 41. There's the snap to Jesse. Pump fake to the left. Now rolls the pocket to the left side and being chased by Marquell Bryant. And he'll have to throw the ball out of bounds here on the near side. Closest receiver in the area to me, it looked like Kyle Echols. Not sure that's what Jesse was looking at, but looked like he was the closest guy. Second down and 15 now for the White Squad. But back to Daniel Sams, playing strictly receiver for the most part in the springtime. Bill Snyder would tell you, I think he's learning and doing pretty well, Stan. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, it's a hard process to change to a new position.
Back to throw is Ertz, under some pressure, and he is touched back there by Ryan Mueller, among others. They'll mark him down back at the 43 for a loss of a couple. Downstairs, here's Matt.
Stan, outside of a little gray, you really haven't aged very much over your years with the network. Well, the guy I'm standing by doesn't look like he has aged a bit since his days at Kansas State. The one and only Darren Sproles with us here on the sidelines, one of the honorary coaches. First, Darren, it's great to see you back here in Manhattan. It's been a while. What do you think of the complex?
It's been about 6 years that I've been back.
Looks a lot different.
Pretty much the whole city have grown. So
Manhattan's growing like gangbusters. You're now a member of the Philadelphia Eagles. How excited are you to be a part of Chip Kelly's offense?
It's going to be fun. It's going to be fun. The kind of offense they have really fits me.
You've been a part of a couple of great offenses, New Orleans and now Philadelphia, and it suits what you bring to the table to a T.
Yeah, it's like to spread everything out, and it really helps me out. You know what I'm saying? Everybody spread out, there's a whole bunch of holes in their defense. So
it's been a lot of fun watching it. Great to have you back in Manhattan, Darren. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
He's got the moves that he did a decade ago. It is so fun to see Darren Sproles back here in Manhattan, Wyatt.
It really is staggering to think about the pro career he's had. We knew he was great coming out of here. Stan, I think the numbers, if I'm not mistaken, are over 15,000 all-purpose yards in the league. Really?
Well,
that's insane.
I like the quote that he had when he said, well, it fits me well.
Yeah.
Any offense fits Darren Sproles well. That's why it's San Diego, New Orleans, and getting ready to go to Philadelphia. He'll have success. And they don't even run him that much. He's a good runner as well as a pass catcher.
Well, the Purple has the ball back after that stop by the Purple defense. Weston Hebert pushing the ball carrier out of bounds. Charles Jones over on the far side at the, let's call it the 16-yard line. A gain of six at second down and four. But great to see Darren. I mentioned saw him at the PowerCat auction last night. He still has a home out in San Diego. Looks good. I think feels good. Is excited about an opportunity in Philadelphia, although I'm sure he would be the first to tell you not all that excited to leave New Orleans. I think he liked it there, liked playing with Drew Brees. Here's a couple of late flags coming in on a run play to the left, and the ball carrier taken down at the 19. Tanner Wood in on the stop.
Well, they love
Charles Jones.
One thing about being a Saint is the whole state loves you.
Holy. Yes. Offense, number 85. Half the distance to the goal, second down.
That football team in New Orleans is everything. I have a lot of relatives down there, and playing on that fast surface in the dome and having Drew Brees, those were all great things for Darren. But, you know, it's the business, and there's a lot of issues like how much money do you have under the salary cap and those kind of things. So the Saints end up begrudgingly trading him to the Eagles. So Philadelphia is a great city, a lot of fun. A little like New York City in the activity on the streets and downtown. But it's going to be a little colder and the field's a little muddy in Philadelphia.
Yeah, Philadelphia will be a little tougher fan-wise, but they're going to love Darren Sproles. There's the snap. Back to throw is Waters into the middle to Zach Trujillo with the catch to the 20, and he'll take it to the 23-yard line. He got a lot of that yardage back, and that will be a first down. Sean Newland makes the stop along with Weston Hebert for the White Squad. It is 7-0 in favor of the Purples, 10:44 to go here in the second quarter. Hope you're enjoying the spring game on the K-State Sports Network and on K-State HD TV. Zach Trujillo with a fine play there to the 23. Here's Waters to throw. Now under pressure, slings it out to the far side for Jones as he was running forward, and the pass wide of the intended target at the 25. And a flag comes in.
Illegal forward pass. Uh-huh. Since he went past the line of scrimmage. Yeah. If they don't say it was a lateral, because it was weird. He looked the pass, then ran up the middle, went past the line of scrimmage, and then swung the ball over to the side, almost a lateral, but they'll call it a forward pass past the line of scrimmage.
Here's Randy Crystal.
Rolling on the field is a backward pass. Second down.
Okay. I could pick that voice out of a million, couldn't you?
Yes.
We've heard it so many
times. So they're saying it was
a
lateral.
Yeah.
And so wherever it went out of bounds, because it becomes a fumble when it's a lateral. I don't think it was a lateral. I think he threw that ball forward.
I think he did too. And off the hands of Jones. I didn't see it hit his hands live play.
It was almost like a no-look basketball pass, the way he was running straight and flung it out to his left.
Second down and 8 for the Purples from the 25. Back to throw as Waters under some pressure. Sidesteps a man with a flag down and throws it up the sideline. Caught at the 42-yard line by Deontay Burton, I should say. Donnie Starks is the stopper on the play. Downstairs to Matt.
Holding. Offense. Number 61. 10-yard penalty. Second down.
You can hear just how windy it is, Wyatt.
Yeah.
Terrence Newman, one of the honorary coaches with us. Were you surprised or, you know, how honored were you when you got the call to be one of the honorary coaches this weekend?
I was very honored. I mean, for them to bring all the former players back each year and then to actually invite me and Darren to, you know, be honorary coaches, it's definitely something that's special.
I know the complex has obviously changed. It's always an eye-opener when you come back, isn't it?
Oh, man, it's amazing. Even seeing the training table. The complex, you know, it's completely different from when we were here. We're relative dinosaurs nowadays, but
12 years in the NFL, what's it like in Cincinnati for you, Terrence?
It's not bad. I mean, you got a great head coach in Marvin Lewis, and yeah, a great coaching staff. The owner, Mr. Brown, is a great owner, and playoffs the last 3 years. Now the big thing is to get that first playoff win and see how far we can go.
Did you have a chance to talk to the team before the game today?
I didn't. I think Darren talked to them last night, though. Kind of let them do their thing and get focused and get ready to showcase their talents to the fans.
You got some new corners. Give them some good tutelage. Good to see you.
You know what? They look pretty good right now. They got some good tools. Good back pedal. Good change of direction. I think they're going to be pretty good.
Denzel McDaniel's kind of built like you.
I would just like to see him, you know, press a little bit, mix it up, you know, throw off the timing. But, you know, they've done well in playing off.
You're one of the honorary coaches. Go get that done.
I can't step in that much. I can't change that much.
Terrence Newman down here on the field, guys.
Thank you, Matt Walters. Nicely done. Purple with a first down while we were visiting with the great former Wildcat they called T-New out of Salina, Terrence Newman. First and 10 from the 35, and Glenn Gronkowski with a carry here. And he gets forward progress, then is pushed back. And they're going to say a loss on the play back to the 33, a loss of a couple for Gronk. And that's Kip Keeley, first time we've talked about him. And Will Geary in on the stop.
Kip Keeley is coming on. His dad, Bill, played with me at Kansas State, and Kip from La Crosse, Kansas, redshirted last year, walk-on player. He's working his way up. He is very solid. He and Trent Tanking are linebackers that are working their way up that you're going to be excited about seeing in the future.
No doubt. Well said. Here's Jake Waters back to throw. Has a little bit of time. Now a bit of pressure. Rolls to the right and throws on the move. And Deontay Burton with a dandy play to come back and catch that ball at the 36-yard line. Near the sideline. He got just 3 on the play, but that is a heck of an effort by Deontay Burton.
And a great effort by Jake Waters to throw the ball against the wind that far, but they only gained 3 yards.
Yeah.
That is a very good job by the defense. Putting pressure on the quarterback right up the middle was Will Geary, who we talked about. And so far, the white defense, you'd have to talk about their performance.
Oh, yeah.
They did a very nice job. They're putting some pressure on the offense.
Well, it's exciting to see this many defensive guys getting in there and being productive. Waters throws far side and wide of Daniel Sams right at midfield. That would have been a first down by a good 5 yards or so, but the pass too wide of Daniel. And it will be 4th down and 9 for the Purple squad, and they'll have to punt it away.
Yeah, the first string offense has not shown any rhythm yet. And it's been a struggle, and against the wind was another factor. They've had a couple of penalties, and here they are punting into the wind from the 36-yard line.
Judah Jones back deep at the 20, awaiting the punt of Nick Walsh. Nick out of Linden, Kansas, gets this one up into the wind, but he gets a bounce on that turf. It'll go inside the 25 and just inside the 22 and will be down there. 7-0 in favor of the Purples, 6:59 to go in the first half and a timeout. This is the K-State Sports Network from Learfield Sports. Purple leading the white 7-0 as we pause now 10 seconds for station identification on the K-State Sports Network. You're listening to K-State Football. Hardworking American farmers need rugged equipment, and nothing is tougher and works harder than a KMW front-end loader. Kansas-made KMW front-end loaders are rugged through and through, just like you. Check them out at kmwagloaders.com and experience the KMW difference. Running play here on first and 10 from the 22-yard line for the white squad in a 7-0 ball game. Joe Huebner is back in at quarterback. Jarvis Leverett is his running back. Colin Sexton into the game for the first time, goes wide to the right. He's joined out there, too, by Michael Mann. Here's a throw to the far side. This is Sexton with the catch, and he's immediately knocked down by Randall Evans, who is a smart and crafty and veteran guy. Saw that one coming. We've seen a lot of good defense today. As a matter of fact, just a total of 125 yards for the purple and 66 for the white as we hit that six-minute mark to go in the second period.
Yeah, it's been about defense, and there's a new position in college football, that starter at nickelback, and Randall Evans is one of the best.
There's the snap. Huebner throws near side. Ball is caught at the 32-yard line near the 33 and a first down. Evans makes the stop. That's the first catch for Dayton Valentine, who is really the number three tight end right now. But again, another young player that the coaches are so pumped up about.
He's a gray shirt, Wyatt. He hasn't used up any eligibility. He's here for the first time in the spring semester. He could redshirt next year, but he has the look that maybe he'll get on the field and not redshirt.
That's for sure. Running play to the right side. And just maybe a couple of yards to the 35, right in the center of the field. A lot of big bodies in there trying to block for Jarvis Leverett, but just not a lot there. But you have to say, to this point, again, the game has been really pretty much dominated by defense, and that kind of goes along with what Bill Snyder has talked about over the last couple of weeks, that more times than not in the first 14 practices, not all of the time, but a lot of the time, the defense has been a little bit ahead, and we've seen that here today. 5:05 to go, first half. Throw to the near side, and Eccles makes the catch on a knee at the 41-yard line. Gain on the play of 7, but shy of the first down by about 2, maybe 3 yards, a couple of yards.
One of the things you see is some experimentation. Luke Hayes is a junior college player from Butler County Junior College, a second-team JUCO All-American, a tackle. He was with the white squad to start the game, starting at the right tackle position. But now we're seeing him move in and play the right guard position. Mm-hmm. And Reed Niver, who normally plays guard, is working at tackle. So they're trying to find what is the best spot. What's the best combination of linemen?
Here's Huebner, hands the ball off. This is Judah Jones to the outside. He's got a first down up the near sideline to the 46-yard line. Knocked out by Nate Jackson. And Judah Jones is a very interesting and talented young guy out of Shreveport, Louisiana. He plays drums for his family's Christian gospel group called Forever Jones, and they've won national awards, Stan. It's quite a story.
Yeah, that's a family business right there,
yeah.
Music.
Yeah.
And now showing some versatility, playing the running back position, even though he was recruited originally out of Shreveport, Louisiana, to play the wide receiver position.
Got a first down, first and 10 at the 46. Huebner hands it off. Again, Judah Jones tries to get to the outside, but Dante Barnett slowed up the player. Make it Mike Moore, and then Ryan Mueller made the final stop for the purple defense. A loss on the play of a couple. It'll be second down and 12 yards to go. 3:50 to go, first half. Purple leading in this game. Our score is 7-0.
Mike Moore is a guy that you talked about who needs to step up and play at a whole nother level. He did some nice things last year. He was in a third down package, rushing the quarterback, was very effective, but now he's one of three starting linebackers with Will Davis and probably Jonathan Truman.
Second down and 12 from the 44. There's the snap. Huebner looks left, now under some pressure, to the right side, and throws, and has Sexton. Collin with a sliding catch at the 38-yard line of the purple. That is a dandy play by not Curry Sexton, but Collin Sexton, the coverage from Dante Barnett.
And a nice throw by Huebner, sticking it in there. Both players make a big play because Huebner was on the run to his right, and Sexton broke his route off, started running toward the sideline parallel to the quarterback, and was able to catch the ball, diving to the ground at the 38 of the purple.
Collin may end up being the Wildcat holder next fall. We'll see. A little bit of a battle there, but you can see his hands are good, and he made a nice play there. And he slides and tries to make a catch here and can't do it at the 39-yard line. That would have been really no gain, maybe a loss of a yard or so on the play. Pass intended for Colin Sexton.
Yeah, they're just throwing the ball down the line of scrimmage. He bubbles out from the slot and starts working toward the sideline. It's really the new version of running plays nowadays, where you throw the ball out to the outside and see if you can get some blocking done by your wide receivers. He dropped the football.
Reed Bergstrom still over that football at center for the white squad. There's the snap. This is Joe Huebner. Throws to the far side. Nice catch by Michael Mann, and he's knocked out of bounds right at the 30 for a gain of 8. A couple of yards needed coming up. Morgan Burns pushed him out there. Third down coming up. 2:53 to go. 2:54, rather. Here in the first half, with the Purple leading 7-0.
I think one thing you could say about this first half is both backup quarterbacks look pretty comfortable. They don't look hurried. They're throwing the ball in the right spot. They're throwing it safely, no interceptions. That's been pretty impressive.
A fairly clean game to this point, which will make Bill Snyder happy. Here is a running play straight ahead, and it looks like it will be a first down for the white squad on the run by Jarvis Leverett. Valentino Coleman brought him to the ground. Here comes big Jordan Willis into the game, replacing Marquell Bryant. The Purple changing a little bit on their defensive personnel. They've got Nate Jackson and Morgan Burns in there at corner. Schellenberg and Dante Barnett are the safeties right now. First down. Football at the 27-yard line. 2:18 to go, first half. White trying to tie this thing up, down 7-0. Huebner back to throw, looking over the middle, sliding try and incomplete at the 3-yard line. And Sexton covered pretty well by Dylan Schellenberg.
Another nice throw. When you're going against a first-string defense, you got to throw the ball safely. And Huebner did that, giving a chance for Colin Sexton to catch that football. But he tried to slide and make the catch, almost had it in his fingertips for a little bit, and then it came out.
Second down and 10 from the 27. Eccles in the game, wide to the right. Two receivers now to the right side, and here is Judah Jones off right tackle. He'll take it inside the 25, close to the 23-yard line for about 4. Randall Evans brings him down right there. We go under 2 minutes to go in the first half. Shermichael Moore back in the game along with Marquell Bryant for the Purple defense, as the white looks at a 3rd and 6 from the Purple 23. The only score of this game, a 14-yard run by Glenn Gronkowski for the Purple with 2:03 to go in the first quarter. Joe Huebner's done a nice job at quarterback today so far, 7 of 11 for 49 yards. Just missed with Sexton there. Now he'll take off, and he is hit right near the 24-yard line, so losing actually a yard on the play trying to run.
They'll call that a sack and touch football for the quarterback, but I thought Huebner made a nice move up the middle. He couldn't get the pass off. He might have been able to break that kind of tackle in the ball game if there is full bore tackling, but they called him down there. You're right. I think Huebner's very impressive, and he has in some of the scrimmages as well. He drove the team down. Now they have a chance for a field goal.
We'll see about this one. It's going to come off the toe of Matthew McCrane, the redshirt freshman from Brownwood, Texas. This one is high. It's a line driver, and right through there. It is good. So that makes it a 7-3 game as Matthew McCrane knocks it through.
He's been kicking the ball well during spring, and he's doing a good job of pushing the starter, Jack Cantelli. Drove that one right through. He had the wind at his back, but that doesn't matter. It was accurate, and he got the ball up in the air quickly, and the white team has scored and is down by only 4 points.
54 seconds to go. McCrane's field goal good from 42 yards away. And again, a 7-3 game.
Now we'll see what the Purple can do in a situation where you got a less than a minute situation. It'll be good practice going against the wind. Can you get the ball downfield, get in a scoring position? There hasn't been a giant spark from the Purple team. They've not had a lot of rhythm yet. And
right. This
situation sometimes can bring the best out of you. We have a sense of urgency and change things up.
That scoring drive, 15 plays for the white squad, covering 54 yards, and it took 6 minutes and 5 seconds.
And Bill Snyder's talking to Jake Waters right now about that situation coming up for the Purple offense.
Kickoff here, and it's going to be taken inside the 5-yard line. And this is Morgan Burns to the 20, middle of the field to the 25. all the way to the 28-yard line. Ended up being a pretty good return. Sean Newland brings down Morgan Burns at the 27. First down there for the Purple with 46 seconds to go. Morgan fielded that one at about the 2-yard line in the center of the field.
One thing you got to take into account is the way K-State's doing kickoffs and kickoff return is they're letting their first-string defense and offense play against each other.
Yeah.
So it's no indication of how things normally would be.
Right.
There's no specialists out there.
Timeout. Purple.
The offensive linemen were out there blocking for that kickoff return. B.J. Finney wondering, what in the heck's going on? Did I make a good block there? Yeah, do not block below the waist on kickoff returns.
Let's look at some of the numbers. Right now, it's 125 yards for the Purple, 60 rush, 65 pass, 114 yards for the White Squad, 49 rush, 65 pass. Jarvis Leverett, 9 rushes, 35 yards with a long of 7. Charles Jones, 7 for 39, his long run, 9. Glenn Gronkowski with the game's lone touchdown, a 14-yard run. And the receiving leaders for the White, Colin Sexton, 2 for 16. And also 2 catches for Stephen West and for Valentine. And for the Purple, Zach Trujillo, 3 catches for 34. Deontay Burton, 3 for 12. And Curry Sexton, 2 catches and 13 yards.
A lot of coaches out on the field talking. Not sure. Should a timeout been charged to the Purple? Bill Snyder can talk to the officials totally differently today. He becomes king rather than just one of the two coaches.
So that's not the case in the fall?
No, it's pretty equal at those times.
Okay, here's a handoff, and this is Jones to the outside left, 30-35, and close to the first down near the 36-yard line. Tanner Wood is the tackler for the White Squad with 33 seconds and counting. Time remaining here in the first half. The Purple leading the White. Our score is 7-3.
And Bill Snyder has chosen to not have any sense of urgency. The Purple is huddling and just acting like it's a normal part of the game rather than a last-second situation.
We're down to 16 seconds to go. Back to throw is Jake Waters. Now he'll take off and run 40 and is going to be hit and touched at about the 44-yard line. He'll pick up 8 and a first down. Donnie Starks is the tackler, and that stops the clock with 8 seconds to go, and now they rewind it.
That'll be the half.
Yes, it will. They will not get off another play. We go to intermission. Thank you, Randy Crystal. At halftime, 30 minutes in, our score, Purple 7 and the White 3. Our halftime show when we come back next after a timeout. This is the K-State Sports Network from Learfield Sports. Snyder Family Stadium, just about a minute away from the start of the third period, with the Purple leading the White. Our score is 7-3. Of course, this will conclude the spring season here today. The Wildcats open the 2014 college football season on August 30th when they play host to Stephen F. Austin in the 6th annual K-State Family Reunion Game. Home dates next fall against Auburn, Texas El Paso, and from the conference, Texas Tech, Texas with a new head coach, Oklahoma State, and, of course, Kansas on Senior Day on November 29th. We very much look forward to the new season. It'll be here before you know it. At least that's what I tell myself every day. I know Stan's kind of the same way. He's football 24/7, 365. But it will get here pretty quickly, won't it?
It will. And the warm weather is starting today, it looks like. The first time in 2014 that it seems kind of warm outside. And it should be awful warm on August 30th when K-State plays a school from Texas named Stephen F. Austin. You say, I never heard of those guys. Well, you have, because Brad Underwood, K-State grad, went down there as a basketball coach and had a great season, got into the NCAA tournament, and actually won a game for the first time. They wear purple, and they will be here. Then you go right into conference play at Iowa State. And then one of the things that are going to be available this year is two Thursday night games, the Auburn game on September 18th, and then later K-State's going to play at West Virginia on a Thursday night. And the schedule's kind of skewed to be home at the beginning of the year. Four of the first five games are at home. To end the year, only one of the last four games, that KU game, is at home. So interesting schedule, a tough non-conference schedule with Auburn, and it almost feels like a tough non-conference schedule. Adding when you play Iowa State in the second game. You're going to play right there in a conference game on the road. Should be a lot of fun.
Ian Patterson will kick off, and he'll do so from our left to our right, from north to south. He'll do so with Morgan Burns holding that football and a couple of guys back deep, Andre Davis and Judah Jones. And this into the breeze will bounce at the 16-yard line. Jones back to the 12 to pick it up. And starts to his left and will go down at about the 13-yard line into the arms of Dante Barnett. So they'll start right there, first and 10 in a four-point game with the purple leading 7-3. Okay, you're a Wildcat fan out there on K-State HD TV watching somewhere in Idaho, or you're listening across the 14-station K-State Sports Network today. How concerned are Wildcat fans supposed to be about what the purple offense did in that first half, Stan?
Well, I think there's got to be some concern. You want the offensive line to be more dominant, but you've got to understand it's a work in progress. At this point of John Hubert's 2012 year in the spring, we didn't see what he could do when he turned it on at Miami. So there is definitely room for improvement. The offensive line will be better when it gets to the fall. But, yeah, it was not a dominating performance by the offense.
Jesse Ertz throws out into the near sideline flat, and the ball is pulled away from Katsourelis by Danzel McDaniel. It's ruled incomplete. So it'll be second down and 10, and Jesse Ertz continues to be pretty solid in what he is doing today. 4 of 5 throwing the football in that first half for 16 yards.
Yeah, both he and Huebner. In fact, Huebner's probably thrown the ball better, but the White offense is doing okay. Now, the couple of things to keep in mind, you got two new starting offensive linemen, you got brand new running backs for the Purple, and, oh, by the way, Tyler Lockett wasn't on the field.
I beg your pardon. They ruled that a catch and a gain of 5, and here's Jesse Ertz running left side, and he is out of bounds. See where they mark him at about the, let's call it the 18-yard line or so. Danzel McDaniel is the guy who runs him out of bounds. It will be third down coming up and about 5 yards to go for the White squad. So Katsourelis did make that catch on first down, a gain of 5. And now it's third and 5 from the 18. Just underway in the third quarter, Purple leading in the game. Lucas Munns in the game as a wide receiver, wide to the right side. Back to throw is Jesse Ertz, fires far side, and boy, it's knocked away by Morgan Burns. Good play there. The intended receiver was the aforementioned Lucas Munns, who is a sophomore, 6'2", 199 out of Hutch.
Burns saw it coming and got his hand there to knock the ball down. You wonder, did he get there a little early? The officials give him the benefit of the doubt, because he came right through the receiver. He saw exactly what he wanted, but he might have been there a little early. It wasn't called.
Mitch Lockbiller will punt the football, stands at his 5. He'll punt with the wind, and this is a terrific spinning kick. It will bounce at the 43 and bounce an angle near side inside the 35 and will roll down at about the 31-yard line. So a good punt there by Mitch. And with 13:24 to go, the Purple will have the football for the first time here in the third quarter.
That, and he caught a bad break, because that ball somehow spun and went sideways. With the wind behind him and bouncing like it did, you would think it would have rolled 15 more yards in the White's favor, but it started turning sideways, and so the Purple will take over at the 31-yard line.
Jake Waters in the first half went 9 of 15 for 65 yards. Let's see what he has up his sleeve here in half number 2. Running play to start. And this is Jones, Charles to the left side, to the 34 for a gain of 3. Weston Hebert is the stopper. And it'll bring up second down and 7. Not quite 2 minutes into this third period. Purple leading 7-3. The Purple scoring on a 14-yard run late in the first period by Glenn Gronkowski. And the White getting a field goal with less than a minute to go in the first half. And here's a throw to the numbers on the right side, ruled incomplete for a diving Deontay Burton. And again, Jake Waters throwing into that very strong south wind. That one a little bit low and behind the intended target.
Not his accurate throw that you'd expect in throwing the ball into the wind and to the sideline. He threw the ball too low for Deontay Burton to get it at his ankles. And we talked about the running backs. We talked about Jones, Leverett, and even Judah Jones. But DeMarcus Robinson has not been in the game.
He has not. Waters is going to run the football, and he's to the 40 and may have a first down at the 41. I believe they're going to give him first down yardage before Kip Keeley touched him and got him down right there. Kip, as we mentioned earlier in the broadcast, a young linebacker that the Wildcat coaches like. Here comes Will Geary back in the ball game. DeAndre Roberts also in defensively for the White squad now.
A couple of guys did not get on the field for the K-State last season.
First and 10 from the 41. There's the snap. Hand off to Jones, and Charles trying to pick his way left side. Just not a lot there. Matter of fact, he'll lose about a half a yard. Couple of tacklers, Will Geary and also DeAndre Roberts. I was not a wrestler, but they tell me that Will Geary is as tough a guy and has outstanding leverage, in part because of his high school wrestling career. He is a strong, strong guy.
Yeah, wrestlers really understand leverage, and in the offensive line, as you get to the highest levels, when you can't dominate another opponent, it's who can get lower, who can get the leverage, and hold the angle for a split second to make a play work.
Second down and 10 from the 41. Waters throws near side. Curry Sexton's got that catch, and he's out at the 47 for a gain of 6 into the arms of Donnie Starks. And we go downstairs to Matt on third down.
You know, Wyatt, I had the opportunity to watch Geary wrestle a couple of times during his Topeka High career, and he is pound for pound one of the strongest heavyweight wrestlers I ever saw. And there have been some good ones around the state, and he was always shorter, but he gave guys problems just like he does offensive linemen. His leverage is something else.
Third down and 4, and a running play to the right side, just really not much at all there. And it'll be fourth down for the Purple as the running back is taken down by Tanner Wood. Tanner got Jones. Let's go back down to if Matt is still there. And Matt, it's an interesting thing. I'll ask both of you guys this. In any way, does he remind you of Tank Reese?
Standing, go first.
Yeah, because Tank was very effective on the inside and not the tallest guy, very strong. Yeah. But I'd say Geary might even be stronger.
Really? Here's a good punt into that breeze, and a fair catch called for by Judah Jones.
Now, Matt said Matt would know he wrestled him.
Yeah, no, not what. And this may sound odd, but I agree with Stan. I think Will Geary is stronger, but I think Tank Reese was a little quicker. He may have had better footwork, but again, Will's just seeing what Division I football is all about. But he was a tremendous football player, and in the Centennial League, he dominated kids on the football field and on the wrestling mat, and he was phenomenal in 6A. I am thrilled for him to have this kind of opportunity, because he could have gone to some other schools, maybe Division II or other universities, but he wanted to give it a whirl at D1, and we all know what the slight on a guy like Will Geary is. He's not tall enough. Well, he's a guy that I think is going to be able to overcome that.
42-yard punt. And here's a keeper for Joe Huebner running to the left, and he'll take it to the 15-yard line for about 3. Dylan Schellenberg moving his way up to the line of scrimmage to make the stop there.
You know, go back to that third down play with the first-string offense. You'd expect them to be able to execute and get it. You mentioned Tanner Wood, a redshirt freshman, Kansas's Gatorade High School Player of the Year from Conway Springs in 2012, and Trent Tanking. They both were there to make the stop, and a couple of young players really coming on made a play on that third down.
Second down and 7 from the 15-yard line. There's the snap. Joe Huebner to throw, and that one is knocked down by Ryan Mueller at the line of scrimmage. A terrific play there by Ryan, who had an All-American season a year ago for Kansas State. Back down to Matt.
One more thing on Will Geary. He's the kind of kid that if you say he can't do something, he's going to prove you wrong.
Oh, yeah.
Big time.
Totally agree. You can tell he's motivated in about everything he does. We are getting our first look at Vernon Vaughn, a wide receiver, a redshirt freshman from Sumner Academy in Kansas City, Kansas, in the game for the first time. Huebner to throw here, and this one is a crossing route, and that ball is caught, and then the ball stripped and taken away by Randall Evans, and it's going to be the Purples' ball just at around the 21-yard line. That throw and catch was made, but then the ball taken away by Randall Evans.
I think that was Jordan Schultz.
It was.
A true freshman. He came here as a walk-on here in the spring semester. His brother Ryan is a basketball player, and he gets a catch, but right there is Randall Evans to make the tackle and force a fumble.
Well, Ryan Schultz, one of our favorites, just a terrific student athlete. And we see his brother there, made a pretty decent catch, but was a little off balance. And then Evans, of course, that veteran guy in there to pull that ball away. So the Purple will have an opportunity to score here. And this is Charles Jones looking for a crease that really doesn't come all that much. Gain a couple on the play to the 20. Weston Hebert is the tackler. And we've called his number quite a bit today as he plays at safety position for the Whites.
Very good special teams player, a captain on the special teams, and now getting a chance as a backup safety to show what he can do.
Miles Copeland comes into the ball game replacing Trent Tanking, linebacker for linebacker there, second down and 8 now. Waters to throw, far side, catch is made by Kyle Klein, and he is spun down at the 14, shy of the first down, a gain of 5. Nate Jackson, corner, makes the tackle on Kyle Klein. And speaking of Kleins, congratulations to Colin. Understand that he has now officially signed a 2-year contract with the Montreal Alouettes of the Canadian Football League. Great to see him back in the game. I'm sure he'll do quite well. Here's the turn and the give. This is Jones. Starts left, angles back to the middle, has a first down at the 10 for a gain of 4. Weston Hebert, the stopper. 9 minutes to go. We're in the third. The Purple threatening with a 7-3 lead here in the third quarter. Gronkowski will come into the game replacing Jones, who got the yardage that time. Klein goes wide to the left. Two receivers to the right, Burton and Curry Sexton. Zach Trujillo tight end on the right side, and back to throw is Jake Waters. Jake has all kinds of time. Now he'll take off and run. He's at the 10, angles left side to the 5, and steps in there to the end zone for a touchdown. Nice job there by Jake Waters, scoring on a 10-yard run. And the Purple with its second score of the day to make it 13-3. Nicely done by Jake. Good read.
Something Jake's done very well all spring, Wyatt, is pull the ball underneath his arm and run. Makes good decisions. He's definitely a passing quarterback, but he has become more of a running threat. And there was an example where all the action in the passing game was over to the right, and he flushed out to the left. That's knowledge of what's going on. He's running to the right place, which makes him a more effective runner, and he's able to get around the left side along the sideline and score a running touchdown.
Jack Cantelli will kick the extra point. He does so out of the hold of Colin Sexton, and a timeout on the field with 8:46 to go in the third, and the Purple leading the White 14-3. This is the K-State Sports Network from Learfield Sports. That's old habit, isn't it? Jack Cantelli, the point after the 10-yard run by Jake Waters. My sincere apologies to
Good memory right there, that you remember that his brother Anthony played here as well.
Yeah, or just old age, one of the two.
Well, Matt was the one calling out old age earlier today.
I talked to Jack this spring at one of the press conferences and asked him how Anthony was doing. He said he's going to do a kicking camp down in Austin, Texas, and is doing well, and glad to hear that. Ian Patterson will kick it off again with the help of Morgan Burns, who will hold that football. And here's a kick that's down the middle, and it's fielded by an up man at about the 14-yard line. This is Judah Jones to the 20. Left side 25 and dragged down at the 27-yard line by Shermichael Moore, linebacker for the Purple squad.
Shermichael looks a lot like that guy Mike Moore.
Yeah, they're the same guy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, same guy.
I just want everyone to know that because
his real name is Shermichael, and that's what he would prefer to be called, because I've asked him specifically about this. The coaches don't like calling him that. They just call him Mike.
Sometimes
and that's
just call
okay
you,
too.
Some coaches will just call you Sam. You never know. You know,
that's true.
And the players usually just go with it. But he wants to honor his dad who played football at Baylor.
That's right. There's the snap. pump fake by Jesse Ertz, throws to the outside, and a juggling catch ruled out of bounds over on the far side. That one incomplete. Morgan Burns was the intended receiver. Yes, that's the same Morgan Burns who is a corner, and he was out there in the corner position that time and almost had a pick.
Yeah, he does a nice job of reading the quarterback. Whenever a receiver breaks a route and doesn't run the right route, some cornerbacks just suck up to the receiver, mm-hmm. blindly playing, and don't care where the football is. Morgan Burns has a capability, he's done it all spring, that if the receiver ends up going the wrong direction and the football's up in the air, he lets the receiver go and gets a chance to intercept it. That time he pulled it in, but he's out of bounds.
Morgan can really run. He's got great speed. And here is a running play, and taking it to the 34-yard line is the ball carrier. That's our first look at Levi Morris today. Danzel McDaniel and Dante Barnett collaborating on the stop. And we weren't sure how much we would see of Levi, but this young guy, who's a redshirt freshman from La Crosse, gets a carry there.
We talked about the running backs, and we haven't seen DeMarcus Robinson, who has a real chance to be the starter in the fall. But a guy coming in is Dalvin Warmack from the Kansas City area. They give the Simone Award to the best player in the metropolitan area from Kansas or Missouri. He's the only player ever to win it 2 years in a row, both his junior and senior years.
Well, he'll certainly have a chance when he gets here this summer. Jesse Ertz breaks a tackle and runs to the left, 35 to the 40, and they're going to say he was touched at about the 36-yard line. So a gain of right at 7. Will Davis is the guy that will be credited with the stop. And that is just shy of the first down mark by about a yard.
That Simone Award, for instance, was won by Darren Sproles when he was at Olathe North. And he didn't win it 2 years, even though he put on a show his sophomore, junior, and senior year. So it's pretty impressive that Dalvin Warmack was able to do that 2 years in a row. From Blue Springs High School, one of three players from that high school that signed with Kansas State.
Oh, yeah. Fourth and a yard from the 36. Pretty good snap. And Mitch Lockbieler with a kick very, very high. Fair catch called for, and Daniel Sams made the catch, dropped it, and then got back on it at the 21-yard line. So with 7:03 to go in the third, the Purple will get the ball back with a 14-3 lead. Yeah, Coach Snyder has been asked about Dalvin Warmack a couple of times this spring, and I think he believes, Stan, and it's hard for freshmen to come in and play right away, but if he can handle the environment, he's good enough. We'll see how that all plays out. It's going to be an interesting fall camp when we get to that
point. Yeah, normally you can't count on him. I mean, there's no Darren Sproles didn't play his freshman year.
Yeah.
You know, there's a lot to learn, and it's too much to expect. But timing is everything as well, and he doesn't have an established starter in front of him, so maybe he can get in the mix.
Running play here on first down. This is Charles Jones, and good defense by the White. That is just superb defense by Logan Thompson. Nice play.
Right into the backfield and a two-yard loss. And we're starting to see the White defense now get a little swagger. We talked about the offense doing that on an early possession. They got down and got a field goal. And this defense gaining a little confidence, playing very well play after play against the first-string offense.
Logan, good size, 6'3", 225, a redshirt freshman backer from Sedgwick, Kansas. Back to throw is Jake Waters, throws, and this is Sexton, middle of the field, 30, first down to the 35-yard line. That's 16 yards on the play for Curry Sexton, and for Curry, his fourth catch of the afternoon. Jackson and Cameron Morgan in on the stop for the White squad. 6 minutes, 17 seconds to go. We're in the third quarter. The Purple leading the White. Our score is 14-3. Waters again awaits the snap. There it is. He has plenty of time to throw. Now he's pressured a bit and is going to be knocked down by Logan O'Day. Nice play by Logan. And there's a guy we haven't even talked about, and we've talked about a lot of defensive linemen here today. So Logan O'Day gets in on the mix.
Yeah, we talked about six of them. It shows you the depth that you have in there. And then Logan O'Day is the seventh one at the defensive tackle position. And it's a source of depth for the Wildcats. You may not have a first-team All-American player there, but you got a lot of guys. And today, with defensive tackles, they rotate a lot. You need more than two. You can have four or five and still let them all play.
Here's the snap. Jake Waters hands it off. This is Charles Jones trying to get to the outside, struggling to do so, and he'll be pulled down at about the 37-yard line by Jordan Coopersmith. There's another guy that we haven't talked a lot about today, but Jordan makes the play. He's out of St. Thomas Aquinas High, defensive end at 6'5 and 250. He's a redshirt junior. Just kept pursuing down the line of scrimmage and got to Charles Jones. It'll be third down and 8 from the 37-yard line for the Purple. 5 minutes to go in the third. Purple 14 and the white 3. There's the snap. Waters back to throw. Jake looking. Now will run. He's at the 40. Angles to the left. 45 and is going to be marked down just shy of the 45 by Logan Thompson. Hey, homeowners, no matter if your home project is big or small, don't make a judgment call. Always call 811 two full working days before you dig.
They touch him down just short of the first down, so it's going to be a fourth down play. And rather than punt the football, the Purple is going to run a play.
At the 44, far left hash, I formation set as Gronk is in the game. Gronkowski, the fullback. Charles Jones, the running back. Gronk will get the call here, and he will get the first down, it would appear, as he gets to the 46-yard line and got a couple on the play. Gronkowski stopped on the play by Miles Copeland, a linebacker from Wichita Collegiate, among others. Also in there was Taylor Godinet, a defensive end from Wamego.
And remember, the defense cannot load up and play a fourth down pressure defense. They got to play the regular defense. They did a pretty good job stopping him from gaining a lot of yardage, but Gronk still got in and got the first down. Looks like Jake Waters is going to burn a timeout here.
Mm-hmm.
Timeout. Purple. Their first timeout.
So they'll take the timeout. We'll keep it right here with 3:51 to go in the third. Purple on top, 14-3. Sideline update with Matt.
Question for Stan. You know, finals are coming up, but this is the final of spring football, so to speak. Stan, what's the process like, you know, after this game and watching film, getting critiqued by the coaches, and then as you start the summer, you're going to get a couple of weeks off before you've got to, you know, be back here for the off season. But what's the period like now, and what do these players hear from their coaches over the next few days?
Well, they all will have an exit meeting, a one-on-one meeting at the end of spring to talk to the coach about their prospects and what they need to do to improve in the summer. And then where they are academically, there's a lot of focus right now on finishing the semester strong, getting your grades as the best they can be, and get through finals. Then they'll have a week and a half or off or so before summer semester starts, and they'll be right back working again. There'll still be a lot of weightlifting and stuff happening even during this period, but the focus will be on academics.
First and 10 for the Purple Squad under the direction of Jake Waters, and a crossing route here. Daniel Sams with his first catch of the day right at midfield. He picks up 4 and tackled by Logan Thompson on the play. It'll be second down and 6 coming up for the Purples, who lead 14-3. 3 minutes, 30 seconds to go here in the third quarter. Sexton and Sams will go wide to the left this time. And out wide to the right side is Stanton Weber. Waters in the gun, gets the snap, hands it off to Charles Jones, and he is ridden down by Chris Brown into the white territory to the 47-yard line for a gain of 3. It'll be third down and 3 coming up.
There's no doubt the Purple, the first string's trying to get the rhythm.
Yeah.
There's a little bit of quicker pace in and out of the huddle. I'm sure after that timeout, Jake Waters gets a chance to talk to the coaches. Remember, Jake's calling the plays, and I'm sure they said, create rhythm out there. Get in and out of the huddle. Get you guys feeling good about themselves, and maybe you can start driving the football more consistently.
Third down and 3 from the 47 of the white for the Purples. Here is Jake Waters on a keeper, and he's going to run to the right side. Takes it to the 45 for 2, a yard shy of the first down. Brown and Davis Clark in on the stop. Davis is another guy that the Wildcats use as a defensive end. So, again, we talk about that defensive front seven depth. And more coming in the fall with Devontae Derricott and Isaiah Riddle and possibly Terrell Klinkscales. It's going to be a fun fall camp when we get there. 2:12 to go. Here is Jones to the left side, and he will lower his shoulder and take it on fourth and a yard for a first down all the way to the 43. So he picks up a good 2+, and the stop made by Benugli.
A lot of patience. Remind you of how John Hubert ran. He hung short of the first down for a long time with his blocker, following the block of Drew Little, but he knew where everything was developing, and as soon as he saw the gap, allowed the blocking to occur, then he burst upfield and got the first down easily.
By the way, good to see Joseph Benugli in the game. He has really been injured a lot of the time that he's been at K-State and in there playing, getting some snaps now. Here's a throw down the far side, and it's knocked down at the 6-yard line intended for Daniel Sams. Corey Jackson there defensively for the white squad.
He was open for a while. Daniel Sams got behind the defender,
But throwing into the wind and after reloading, Jake Waters, which rarely happens, came up just slightly short. It wasn't intercepted, but it allowed a defender to get back, and Corey Jackson was able to knock it away before Daniel Sams could get to the football.
Jake Waters today, 13 of 21 for 96 yards, looking now at 2nd and 10 here. The Purple into the white territory at the 42. Waters throws right side, catch is made at the 37 by Daniel Sams, and he is wrestled down there by Brogan Berry, young man from the secondary for the white defense. So Sams with his second catch of the afternoon, and Kyle Klein back into the ballgame. It'll be 3rd down and 5 for the Purple squad here, 3rd and 5, and Sams to the sideline as Deontay Burton checks back in the game. Back to throw. Waters into the middle. Sexton's got it. Should have a first down and will right at the 30-yard line. Got 7. Brogan Berry makes the stop. So Curry Sexton with another catch. That gives him 5 on the day. That leads all receivers in the spring game. Again, if you're just joining us and you're wondering where Tyler Lockett is, he's here but not playing today.
Purple. Their second timeout of the half.
Timeout is called, and this is an interesting moment here. As we get ready to see something that is quite unique, Ryan Mueller, who is an All-American defensive end for the Wildcats, this last November made friends with a young man from the Kansas City area, a young boy by the name of Caden Schroeder, who was at the time struggling with cancer. They have become very, very fast friends. Ryan took him a football as he was undergoing chemotherapy in the Kansas City area. And he is dressed in a Wildcat uniform as Caden Schroeder, and he's going to get to run a play here as Coach Snyder runs him out onto the field. How about that? And the fans are now recognizing this. What a touching moment here with just under a minute to go.
Those linemen in front of you when I was the quarterback were big, and they've gotten bigger. Can you imagine how big they look to him as he's in the backfield as a running back?
Oh, yeah. Caden Schroeder is in the game, and he is going to get to run the football. Jake Waters helping him as he runs to the right side. He's at the 20, to the 15, to the 10, and little Caden's going to score a touchdown for the Purple. How about that? 30 yards for Caden Schroeder. We're told that this young man is continuing to battle cancer right now, and the entire Wildcat grouping of players headed to the end zone to congratulate this young man. What a special moment here at Bill Snyder Family Stadium as this young fella is up on the shoulders of, among others, Ryan Mueller, who made friends with him last year. What a touching thing.
Yeah, they're carrying him off with the whole team around like you would a head coach with him on his shoulders. And Ryan Mueller, who wasn't on the field, sprinted down there first to give his buddy a high five. It's nice when you can see these things happen. We were able to see some pictures of when he was in the hospital and when Ryan Mueller was visiting. He looked pretty healthy running for a touchdown right there.
He sure did. Caden Schroeder goes all the way for a touchdown. And let's hope that he remembers that for a long, long time. Look at all those purple shirts out in front of him there, and Jake Waters following him into the end zone. What a great thing. That is terrific. Outstanding. Boy, Ryan Mueller is such a terrific young guy. There are so many on this football team, but boy, he has stayed with this young guy, and they've been friends, and Ryan continues to help him and support him in every way possible. That's awesome. Very, very great. 44 seconds to go in the third. The Purple leading the white. Our score is 14-3. Jake Waters, they're going to go back and start again here on first down. Jake will throw to the near side. Curry Sexton's got it at the 23, and he is close to the 20-yard line and a first down. It appears he has it with 52 seconds to go in the quarter. John Curry, athletic director at Kansas State, stepping into the booth with us here. Headset here on John. What a touching moment there for Caden Schroeder and the Wildcats. Huh? Wasn't that awesome?
That was really a special deal, and hats off to Coach Snyder and to Ryan Mueller and the whole K-State family for making that happen.
First down and 10 Play fake here. Waters rolling left, throwing that way. Kyle Klein with a terrific catch and sidesteps down the sideline inside the 10 to the 9. First and goal for the Purple. John, it's always a special time of year with the Power Cat auction on Friday night, the spring game on Saturday. We've got a good crowd, but maybe even more so today for a lot of reasons, but especially the announcement in pregame about what's going to happen after this next football season with the renovation of the Veneer Football Complex.
Well, it is a great day in the history of Kansas State, Wyatt, with the announcement of the new Veneer Football Complex and the Veneer Football Challenge. We're going to knock down the existing building, and we'll start at the end of this football season on the next step and the next generation.
Here's a throw to the end zone by Jake Waters. They're going to rule it is incomplete, and Deontay Burton thought that he caught that ball, but they're saying that he did not, juggled it, and is out of bounds. And that will be our final play of the third. John will come back with us to start the fourth, and it's 14-3 Purple after three. This is the K-State Sports Network from Learfield Sports. Seconds for station identification on the K-State Sports Network. This is K-State football. Well, we start the fourth quarter with our score 14-3 in favor of the Purple. I'm Wyatt Thompson with Stan Weber, Matt Walters, and crew, and joined here by Kansas State Athletic Director John Curry. It really has been a special day for a lot of reasons. We'll continue to visit with the Athletic Director at K-State about that here, and here's a running play to the left side for Charles Jones, and good defense as they stretch that out and knock Jones out at the 10 for a loss of a yard. John, I'm sure you're going to get several questions over the next several months about this particular project, but at the end of the day, much like the West Stadium Center, I think it's really about the student-athlete experience when you put that thing together and get it going, right?
Well, this new facility is going to bring lots of things to K-State Athletics and the entire university, but the two fundamental principles of this facility are grassroots fan experience and student-athlete experience, and all of our student-athletes will benefit. The weight room, strength and conditioning facilities will double. We'll have a wonderful new student-athlete sports medicine area. And then, of course, our academic center will be significantly expanded.
Waters lobs to the back of the end zone, but it is knocked away by Corey Jackson, the corner, 5'9", redshirt freshman from St. Joseph, Missouri Central High School. It'll be fourth and goal, and we'll see Cantelli come on for a field goal try to make this a two-touchdown game.
So one of the things, Wyatt, that people ask about as we drive into the end zone here is the seating in the north end zone, which is a family-friendly general admission zone. It's been very popular, and it's kind of become part of who we are with the accessibility of the fans to the students, and that'll be one of the things that continues in the new building.
Here's the kick from the 17, a 27-yard try that is good for Cantelli to make it 17-3. And it's an interesting point that you bring up, because it will change a little bit, but still for the fans it's going to be spectacular.
It's going to be really nice. The fans that sit in the north end zone will have access eventually to the east and west concourses, and we'll have a true 360-degree concourse. Now, this will be a two-part process. The first year, in time for the 2015 season, the main building in the northwest corner concourse will be done, and then we'll come back hopefully for the 2016 or 2017 season and fill in the northeast corner, which is the hill adjacent to our student section, and at that time we'll have a concourse that goes around the whole deal. If you look at our stadium right now, fans can think about the existing Veneer complex, and right above the play clock, the roof of the existing building is about the height of the concourse on the east side and the west side. So the new building, that'll be about the level of the concourse, and then the building rising above that concourse in the north will be just a little bit taller than the existing Minitron and the Coventry Health Center sign that's on top of the Minitron on the north end.
John Curry is our guest as we get the kickoff here to the white squad, and this one will be about 7 or 8 yards deep, and the white squad will try to bring it out. This is Kyle Eccles to do so, and he does not get to the 15. He's down at the 13-yard line, probably better served to just hold that one into the end zone. But it's now a 17-3 lead for the Purple with 14-14 to go.
A key word that Athletic Director John Curry has used a couple of times is building. Because when you drive up now in the West Side Center, you notice it's not just suites or press box. It's a building that you've built over here. And the thing that stood out to me more than anything else is we saw the drawings is on the north side, you're going to have a giant complex. It's going to be a building over there.
Running play here, and this is taken to the 20. Well, they'll mark him down at the 19-yard line, and that is Jarvis Leverett with the carry. And for Jarvis, that is his 10th carry of the day, and that'll get him up over 40 yards on the play.
So, John, the architecture looks so much like the West. It's so congruent. It's so giant. I mean, talk about that, how it's going to change the viewpoint as you drive into Manhattan.
Well, it is. I'll take it one step further. It's more than a building, right? Because the West Stadium Center is really the entry to the stadium. The new veneer complex will be the entry to our athletics program and our football program. And the architectural vocabulary of limestone and materials that look like the state of Kansas will certainly be continued in the new North End building.
Vernon Vaughn with a catch here from Joe Huebner for a first down for the White Squad at the 30-yard line.
Talk about a couple of the aspects to just try to describe to the fans of what they'll see when they come in there and some of the things that are added that you don't have now, probably including a different video board on this end of the stadium.
Sure. Well, video boards have been part of this project from the very beginning. We will not have a video board on top of the new building. We'll actually use two corner boards eventually in the northwest and northeast corner. And then long-term, Stan, and not too long a term, I would add, we do aspire to replace the south end video board with a much larger video board in the south end. The two corner boards in the north end zone will be about the size of the existing south end video board.
Wow.
So over the next several years, we're going to continue to be great customers of Westar Energy with more electricity drawn for those video boards.
Once again, John Curry, athletic director at Kansas State, is our guest here early in the fourth quarter with the Purple driving and leading the White 17-3 with 12:40 to go. You spoke last night early on at the PowerCat auction across the way at Bramlage Coliseum, and I'm certainly paraphrasing here and not quoting. Don't want to put words in your mouth, but one of the things that you talked about was maybe changing a little bit the way the Wildcat fans talk and look about the facilities improvements and so on and so forth. And one of the things you somewhat talked about is it's kind of changed to, well, we may be able to do that, we may not be able to do that, and now it's like, what's next? And I salute you for that, because you've got a lot of K-State people on board with this, and they're excited about this, obviously, and should be.
Well, I think the passion and the abilities are always been there for K-State people.
Sure.
And that's the people that built this state and built the university and then have supported Coach Snyder in building this program. But I think even more we've elevated what people outside the K-State Nation see here. And as we've made accomplishments, I think we've grown in confidence a little bit that we can get more done.
Here's Huebner over the top to Judah Jones, and he will score. He takes it all the way from 48 yards for the White Squad. Judah Jones, we talked about him earlier, but he got behind everybody there, Stan Weber, and took it to the house from Joe Huebner.
Yeah, the safety's got beat on the post pattern, and what I really like is Huebner's arm strength. Not only did he recognize he had a guy deep, he stuck it on him, throwing into that strong wind, and the White has a touchdown to pull within a touchdown here in the second half.
We're in the fourth quarter with 11 minutes and 47 seconds to play in the football game, and we'll see about the extra point off the toe of Matthew McCrane, who hit a field goal for the White Squad earlier, and he'll boot this one right through there to make it a one-score game, 17-10 with 11:47 to go in the fourth quarter.
When we talk about this building, we talk about first impressions, and first impressions matter, and details matter. And so we've done a lot of planning to make sure that it's as highly functional and efficient for all of our student-athletes as possible and our coaching staff as possible. When you walk into the new basketball training facility, or we bring a recruit in, we walk into the West Stadium Center, we walk into our training table right now, we walk into our new intercollegiate rowing facility, the first impression is really, really powerful and makes a difference. And we need to upgrade the first impression feel as of walking into the existing building. You know, I will say that building has served us so well for 40 years.
Sure.
And there have been very sensible and appropriate additions over time that have all served their purpose. And so that building has served us to this point, just like the old Dev Nelson press box did for the last 20 years before we built the West Stadium Center. And we got to take that next step forward. And I believe it'll be one that really will complete. And I don't mean that we're done, right? But we'll take another huge leap forward in terms of what we look like. And you know, we're competing in a realm of intercollegiate athletics that is incredibly competitive, and we need to operate from a position of strength and leadership.
Well, the other thing that I think fans need to take into account, just like an athlete who warms up before a game to get in the rhythm, or a basketball player starts getting hot and you want him to shoot more, he's been doing it. We're at a position now where, because you went through all of this construction, all the work that goes into the details of the West Stadium Center, you guys are kind of in a rhythm with the basketball facility now. This, you know what questions to ask, how to work with the architects, and I think it makes the whole process more efficient than waiting 10 years and trying to remind yourself. Everyone really is focused on what needs to be done to have it in the details be complete well.
Daniel Sams running back that kickoff and taking it out of bounds over on the far side at the 31, and then showing his great athletic ability, jumping over that seating over there, and the fans getting a big kick out of that. So the Purple up 17-10, will have the ball first and 10 at their own 31 with 11:41 to go in the ball game. John, the cost a little bit. Go ahead.
Well, let me go back to what Stan just said a minute ago, because that is an element that has been extremely helpful. And I think probably the general public doesn't realize how much planning and organization goes into the whole building process. And we have great people within the athletics program and then within the university administration and then in Topeka. And I will tell you something, you know, being in other states, the people that work in our state building office, our state fire codes office, that work, they really, really work hard to serve the people of the state of Kansas. And we appreciate their cooperation and their help and their proactivity in building this building, and that was one of the things that helped get this thing done on time last year.
Jake Waters with a terrific throw to Deontay Burton into white territory all the way to the 41-yard line. He had some zip on that throw, and that's the kind of Jake Waters throws we're going to probably enjoy a lot next fall, fellas.
Yeah, I'm not worried about him. And I'm not worried about John and his construction stuff either. I have complete confidence.
Me too.
I just wonder, where's Bill Snyder going to sit in the interim, because we want him to be focused.
Here's a throw again into the middle. This one for Curry Sexton inside the 20 and hit hard and ridden down at about the 16-yard line.
There's a lot of things I worry about day-to-day, Stan. Bill Snyder being focused is not one.
Okay, good. All right. Well, me either. But it's a fun question. Like, Bill Snyder, will he just say, I'll sit right here, put a 2x2 cubicle, put a construction around me, and I'll just sit right here and stay to work?
Right below us. We'll actually use this facility in the interim.
That's great that you have it right here.
And that's part of the process, was create some space that would be versatile, and we'll use this facility for most of the office and academic functions of the current north end zone.
Oh, here's a throw into the middle that's picked off in the secondary by Nate Jackson, and Jackson taking that ball back to the 25, to the 30, getting some blocking up the far sideline across the 40 and bumped out shy of the 45-yard line. That's really one of the few mistakes that we've seen today from this Wildcat bunch, but Nate Jackson picking off Jake Waters there. I just don't think he saw him. I really don't.
Late over the middle is always dangerous, and there you see Nate Jackson, a starting cornerback today, and a guy fighting for a starting position, makes a nice interception at the goal line and then a nice return out to the 44. Wyatt DeWhite is only 7 points down with 10:24 left in the fourth quarter. They have a chance to tie.
Yeah, John, I know you've been busy running around doing a lot of things, but in the little bit of the game that you've seen, what has been your impression so far of Bill Snyder's bunch?
I've seen 5 plays. I've been running around. I did like a long halftime deal with the media. But I tell you, where I like seeing him is I saw him. Larry Veach and I had an early morning visit with one of our contributors and in one of the floors. And so I actually saw all our guys, including Stanton Weber, coming into the training table to have their pregame meal.
Yeah.
And this was at 10:30 in the morning, 9 o'clock, whatever it was, 8:30, whatever. And they were all coming in their cat coats, and they're all dressed, just like it was always,
sure,
ready for the game.
Jarvis Leverett with a nice run here of 4. It's second down and 6 for the White as they near midfield at the 48-yard line. And Jesse Ertz swings this one out to the left side, and taking it to midfield is the aforementioned running back for the Wildcats, Jarvis Leverett. Let me ask you one more here before we let you go. Obviously, I'm going to guess that you have had a lot of fun this weekend for a lot of the reasons that we've talked about, but also being able to get to know a little bit Terrence Newman and Darren Sproles and what they are all about with Kansas State football. Those are two terrific young guys.
It's not hard to like either one of those guys.
That
they
is
have
for
been
sure.
so supportive, and I've got to know them several years ago, and appreciate them making the effort to come here today. And I think they've really enjoyed interacting with our fans, and they understand the connectivity here between the fans and our program. And they both, I think they're having a ball, and, they're both coaching up a good game, right?
Yes, they are. Even though they won't take any credit for it, they've done a nice job. Before we let you go, one more on the – let's talk about money and the cost of the facility to our left here. I'm sure you're going to get asked a little bit about that. Tell us about the cost of this facility.
So the project cost that we're going to work on completing by August 1, 2015, is about $65 million.
Okay.
And so we need to raise $50 million outright gifts. Right now we're about 75% of the way there. So we need to raise another $12 or $13 million to build this building. And then the other $15 million, between $50 and $65 million, will be dollars we use from annual from department receipts, just operating revenue from Ahern Fund gifts and ticket sales and et cetera. So we'll be able to fund this building without having to do any long-term bonds, which is important because there's not direct revenue streams associated with this building. So we're working really hard. The key thing is we're off to a great start from a fundraising standpoint, but finishing, and we talked about let's finish on the top of the slate at the
right.
end, finishing and getting the ball into the end zone, it takes everybody's support and everybody's help. And all those last details that make this facility special and make the West Stadium, the basketball training facility special, those are $500 increments and $5,000 increments and more to make the facility truly great for the student athletes and for our purposes.
Yeah, that's what I was saying to myself. You talked about it being named the Veneer Football Complex, and I was with Mr. and Mrs. Veneer earlier today in their box, and just congratulated and thanked them for what they've done for Kansas State with a great gift. I do a lot with the business college, $10 million going over there, a lot going to athletics. They care about all the right things, academics, athletics, and everything else. And getting their support is giant. You've got to have those big donors to start the numbers you're talking about. But you know what? When you get down toward the end, you finish it off a lot of times with everyone bouncing in with $500, $1,000, $10,000. Things that are manageable for a lot of fans are the ones who take it across the finish line. So thank you, Jack Veneer. But you know what? Everyone can contribute and get this job done.
And one of the most inspirational things to the whole family, that whole family, has been the way our broad-based support has grown over the last 5 years.
Yeah.
And you're exactly right, Stan. One of the neatest things about this facility is the bricks that enabled over $1 million worth of gifts to participate in building this facility that we're standing in right now. And so people that have joined the Ahern Fund, we went over 10,000 members for the first time ever. We've almost doubled membership over the last 5 years. That people can do that for as little as $50 a year. People that are coming to games and can make it to a couple games, people that are buying season tickets, and then people that make that find it in their heart to make an outright gift to this facility will help put it over the top.
Well, we're so excited of what's going on today and into the future. John, we appreciate all you do. Keep up the great, great work. K-State is strong. Big 12 is strong. It's a good time to be a Wildcat, isn't it?
It is always great to be a Wildcat, but right now is certainly a very special time. And the most special thing about it is that it really feels like everybody's pushing on the wheel in the right direction.
For sure.
The energy and the momentum and our fans achieving 13 consecutive sellouts. And this year, again, I believe that we'll be sold out almost every game, if not every game. That just is not happening around the country like it's happening at K-State at very many places. And so we thank all of our fans from the bottom of our hearts. And I know our student athletes feel very grateful for the opportunities they have here at Kansas State.
Jesse Ertz throwing to the near sideline. That ball is caught by Stephen West inside the 15 to the 14-yard line. John, thanks again for a great, great weekend and all you do. Keep up the great work, sir. We really appreciate it.
Thank you, Wyatt.
Thanks, John.
Thank you, Stan. Appreciate you guys and look forward to seeing you soon.
Another thing that Curry has going for him is there's not very many teams around the country that have home games that include Auburn, Texas, and the Kansas Jayhawks finishing off the season here. This is the year. It's easy to say, I need my season tickets. Yeah. I want to watch those games.
Well, he is an award-winning athletic director, and we're proud to have him. Don't forget, we want you here on August 30th for that sixth family reunion. We know you will be here. There's no question about that. We've got a penalty on the play. We're in the fourth quarter with 5 minutes and 36 seconds to go. Purple leading the white 17-10, and the white has put together a pretty good drive here. They have it second down and 8 from the 19-yard line. That was a false start. Just just a moment ago.
Going into the wind with a chance to tie.
Back to throw is Ertz, and this ball is deflected at the line of scrimmage by Matt Seiwert. Good play by Matt to get a hand on that one.
Matt Seiwert, one of those guys coming on as a defensive tackle, gets his hands up and knocks the football away. But I've been impressed all day long. We've talked about it early, how comfortable both quarterbacks, Jesse Ertz and Joe Huebner, have looked. And that continues as they have a touchdown drive on a long pass from Joe Huebner, and in right back, Jesse Ertz has driven the team inside the 20-yard line.
How about this? 10 plays, 37 yards on the drive so far for Jesse Ertz and company. And Jesse wants to throw here, dances in the pocket, and cannot get away from the pressure of Shermichael Moore, who got a hand on him, and that's all it takes today to get the quarterbacks down. That sack will be credited at the 29-yard line. And with 5 minutes to go, the White will try for a field goal here from Dylan Wilson, the junior out of Midlothian, Texas. No, it's going to be Ian Patterson, I beg your pardon, and it'll be Dylan Wilson who holds it. Patterson did such a fine job kicking last year for Cantelli, and this one is on the way, and it is good. He got it. That one is good. That was 40-plus yards for Ian Patterson.
I think it's 46 yards for Ian. Into
nice
the wind.
How about that? And that makes it a 17-13 game with 4:40 to go and a timeout. This is the K-State Sports Network from Learfield Sports. 13 in favor of the Purple with 4:40 to go after that 46-yard field goal by Ian Patterson, a 12-play, 27-yard drive that took 5 minutes and 44 seconds. Wildcat weekends are made better when booking with the new Bluemont Hotel. Located next to K-State in Aggieville, this boutique-style hotel offers a chic design, suite-style rooms, and distinctive event space. Book today at BluemontHotel.com. Dylan Wilson will kick it off for the White squad from the 35-yard line and into the breeze. This one hangs up a bit. Morgan Burns with the catch to the 20. Angles far side to the 30. 35-40. Burns to midfield. And finally run down inside the 50-yard line near the 46. Let's go downstairs to Mr. Walters.
No, it was great to see Patterson hit that field goal, and it was like a golf shot. In that strong a breeze, you got to keep it low. One of the most interesting comments I've heard during spring football came from Jack Cantelli, and that was the fact that he is as healthy as he has been since he was in high school. So you're talking a good 4 or 5 years. His strength, Patterson, what he did last year. I think K-State's got some good guys behind Cantelli, and we'll see what happens with the punters. But pretty strong kicking core right now here at K-State.
That's for sure. And a 39-yard return there by Morgan Burns. And the carry to the right side, Davis Clark, makes the stop on the running back, Charles Jones. For Charles, his 19th carry of the day. He had gained 66 yards prior to that one. And really virtually no gain here. Second and 10 coming from the 46-yard line of the White for the Purple. The Purple with 4:04 to go, clinging to a 17-13 lead. Here's Jake Waters back to throw. Waiting. Now over the middle it goes. This is Jones with the catch, and Charles takes it to the 40 for 6. And it's Trent Tanking, the linebacker, who makes the stop. It's going to bring up third down for the Purples. Third down and about 3 from the 40, make it the 39-yard line. Sams will come wide to the left. Trujillo tight end on the left and two receivers wide to the right. Back to throw is Waters. Far side, caught by Burton, and he sidesteps one tackler and will take it down to about the 32-yard line. Ed Brown is the guy who finally knocked him out of bounds over there. Deontay Burton with another catch. And for Deontay, that is his 6th catch of the day. Curry Sexton has 7 to lead the Purple squad.
Those guys are going to have to really step up and keep the pressure off of Tyler Lockett. Every team is going to have their focus on Tyler, and as well as these other guys play will really define how open Lockett will be able to be and how straight they've got to cover them.
That was an 8-yard gain. Waters throws to the sideline here. That's Gronkowski with a nice catch, and Gronk will take it inside the 30 down to about the 26. Logan Thompson is the tackler. So that's a gain on the play of about 6 yards. It's second down and 4 with 3 minutes to play in the ball game, and the Purple leading 17-13.
Tremaine Thompson has graduated, but he deserves a lot of credit for being
yes.
the helper. He would hurt people if they put too much focus on Tyler Lockett, and K-State's going to need Burton and Sexton to do that job this year.
Second down and four. Here's a throw to the far side for Weber, and that one is incomplete. He left his feet to go get it, tried to get it, and he short-hopped it incomplete. Ryan Mack in coverage for the White Squad. It'll be third down and four. Daniel Sams will come out of the ball game as Deontay Burton checks back in. Burton and Sexton go wide to the right. Stanton Weber comes wide left. Big play here, third and four from the 26 for the Purples, and this is a throw underneath to Gronkowski, and he stretches for that first down mark and has it at the 21-yard line. Nice play there, the tackle from Corey Jackson and Logan Thompson. That'll burn some more clock for the Purples here as they cling to a four-point lead. Well, Gronkowski's just gotten bigger and stronger, much more understanding of what he's doing out there, and you can see it in his play. Nice effort there by Glenn Gronkowski. From the 21-yard line, Jake Waters to throw again. Good protection. Dances in the pocket. Now will run a bit. Angles to the far side. Tries to get to the corner and does to the 20 and is run out of bounds with a penalty flag down late. Chased out by Ed Brown. 2:08 to go in the ballgame. We'll see about the penalty flag. Randy Crystal is the referee here today. He and his crew will sort it out. And Randy will tell us momentarily.
Illegal block in the back. Offense, number six. A 10-yard penalty.
And they'll figure out the down.
First down.
Attaboy, Randy. So Deontay Burton with the illegal block.
And that's experience right there.
Yes.
The play broke down. He was moving around and then decided to change from a receiver to a blocker when he saw Jake Waters go across the line of scrimmage and unfortunately blocked in the back. Instead of having a positive run, they're penalized.
Penalty ends up being 7 yards. It makes it first and 17 from the 28, and Waters to throw here. Jake fires into the middle. Curry Sexton with the catch. Dances inside the 20 and takes it to the 17-yard line. He got about 11 on that play. Will Gary from the defensive front makes the stop. And we go right to that 90-second mark remaining in the game now. 17 for the purple, 13 for the white. Purple has gone up over 300 yards in total offense, 202 of it passing prior to that play. And here's Waters again. Turns, hands the ball off. This is Jones. Jones, Charles takes it to the 10 and has a first down with a minute and 11 to go. Well, they had first and 17 and pick up a first down in two plays. Tackle coming there from Ed Brown and Kip Keeley.
Purple still huddling up, and one thing they're doing is keeping the ball away from the white, who is within one score if they could stop the purple.
It was 14-3 going to the fourth quarter. It's now 17-13 in favor of the purple. Here's Waters, throws near side. Trujillo has it, and he's going to go down at about the 2 or maybe the 1 yard line. Weston Hebert makes the stop. Zach a little bit slow to get up, still setting on his backside, but now up and looks to be okay. It was taken down just kind of in an odd angle and was a bit slow to get up.
And now K-State puts in Leighton Dowling, a defensive end who comes in to help with the offense.
Kind of like that. Big blocker out there. Jones is the running back. It's second and goal from the 1. Handoff is to Dowling, and Leighton wanted to get there and got right to the goal line and was pushed back. This is a guy that's been around the Wildcat program for quite a while. He's a 3-year letterman. Kip Keeley is credited with the stop of Leighton Dowling. Let's see if they give it to him again. They may not get it off. 2 seconds to go, 1 second, and here is Leighton Dowling to the goal line. He got in on the game's final play. Leighton Dowling scores from a yard out on the game's final play, and the Purple with a lead of 23-13. How about that for the Purple squad to score on the game's final play? Leighton Dowling, a defensive end in there at fullback, will score from a yard out.
Yeah, you know, it's been a long time ago, but he left high school early, came in the spring of 2010, and that's going to be a thrill for him to get into the end zone, even if it is just a spring game. Defensive linemen don't get a chance very often.
23-13 is our score. And Leighton still somewhat celebrating that 1-yard run. 23-13 will be our final. Hardworking American farmers need rugged equipment, and nothing is tougher and works harder than a KMW front-end loader. Kansas-made KMW front-end loaders are rugged through and through, just like you. Check them out at kmwagloaders.com and experience the KMW difference. I'm Wyatt Thompson with Stan Weber, Matt Walters, and crew. Our postgame show is here, and we'll talk about this spring game when we come back after a timeout. This is the K-State Sports Network.